So let's start. We come to our day 13 of our AWS session. This is the session 13, one of our AWS course. Okay. Now the remaining days, you know, we have limited days now. Maybe a couple of days left with this course, and the agenda for today will be we'll be talking about the well-architected framework and migration methods. Okay, and we'll have a AWS Cloud Economics Center and course closure and discussions maybe on Friday. So what we have covered, we have already talked about this part. We also covered the management and governance, where we covered the CloudWatch, CloudTrail, monitoring, auditing part. And we covered a topic of database, where we talked about database basics. We talked about the primary DR concept for databases. We talked about single AZ and multi AZ requirement for databases. We talked about types of database used in the AWS Redis module, that is the relational database system, the RDS. Under RDS, we have MariaDB, Oracle, MySQL, and other things. We talk about DynamoDB, that is NoSQL database. Okay. And we just have an high view on the data warehouse. What is data warehouse? Why it is used? The analytic parts and other things. So we are fine until now, right? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So before I come to module 7, there are two things on the database module that I need to speak about. So one is that we talked about Elastic Cache, right? It is used for your in-memory data store, compatible with Redis and Memcached, power real-time application with sub-milliseconds latency. So it benefits are extreme performance, works on in-memory data store and cache to support the most demanding applications requiring sub-millisecond response times. If your database requires a sub-millisecond of your application is demanding sub-millisecond of response times, then we require in-memory database, and for AWS it is Elastic Cache. So it's a fully managed in-memory database system. So you no longer need to perform management tasks such as hardware provisioning, software patching, setup, configuration monitoring, and failure recovery. And it is scalable. So it works. It has two engines to work with. It works with the third-party Redis, and also works with Memcache. So building real times across versatile use cases like gaming, geo services, caching, session stores, and so on. So building a simple, scalable caching layer for your data. So if you want Memcached, it can be a caching layer. So how it works, internet scale applications, real-time apps in gaming, ride-hailing, media streaming, like your OTT platforms, Netflix, Hotstar, Woot, and so on, and dating and social media needs a fast data access. So it is the AWS Elastic Cache comes into picture with fast in-memory data store for this thing, and it suffices the requirement real-time transaction for BI, analytics, session store, and gaming. So these are some of the use cases that we can check it for. So it can be integrated with your RDS, S3, MongoDB, Cassandra, and any database and file stores. If you can see features. So we have already talked about, you can see the pricing part. It has node types of pricing is there. So on-demand nodes, reserved nodes, backup storage, and so on. So if you have a Elastic Cache, available node types. So these are the node types that you can use. And it differs, the pricing differs depending on the node type that you use for the in-memory caching. Same. So the on-demand nodes let you pay for memory capacity for your node runs with a long-term commitment. So the prices differs from region to region. Okay. And there are many things that you can do. So this was one part. We have already explained what is ElastiCache, what is Memcache, and other things. And other part on the data warehouse, this thing, right? We talked about that. We multiple source of like what CRM programs or BI or any other ERP databases or ERP data can be extracted and loaded into a data warehouse where it can we will be having a large compute and memory. This thing, it will be processed, and those data can be used for analytic purposes. So when you talk about data warehouse in AWS, we talk about Redshift. So when we talk about Redshift, we talk all about clustering, right? You can see Equinox was one of the database, one of the ERP provider earlier. But the top are SAP and Oracle. And Microsoft, I think the Microsoft Dynamics and Microsoft SAP HANA is also famous for that. So you can see, if we just increase the size, you can see, so here, this is my data warehouse, what it can do. It can query my database like Aurora, RDS, and operation databases. I can have an S3 query using S3 data lake. And you can have, for analytics, I can use QuickSight and put third party tools. And I can use these many, this for the analytic purposes, right? So EMR, Amazon Athena, and analytic services and all that. So as you can see, performance at any scale, fast, 3 times faster than cloud data warehouses. So Redshift delivers fast query performance in gigabytes and petabytes, and from a few users to thousands, and you can consistently fast results as your workload grows over time. Use cases are there. Business, you can use it for business intelligence and operation for analytic, mostly for analytic purpose. Data warehouse are used. Okay. If you need you're using machine learning and you are using predictive analytics, okay, so this can be used for that. Will be one of the use cases. The process, yesterday we have already talked about what data warehouse, how is the process and how it works, right, on a high level. So you can have, so what is Amazon Redshift? Amazon Redshift is a mostly widely used cloud data warehouse. It's a cloud data warehouse. So it makes it faster, simple, and cost-effective to analyze your data using standard SQL and your existing business intelligence tools. It allows you to run complex analytic queries against terabytes or petabytes of structured data. So if you see the billing part, how I will be charged, you pay on you pay as you use, right? And there is no minimum of setup fees. Amazon Redshift supports the ability to pause and resume a cluster, allowing you to easily submit a suspend. So just to check out how on the portal, if you want to check out how ElastiCache looks like. So this is how it is. You can launch a cluster. Okay, create a cluster. Just a few clicks, you can choose. So cluster, is a group of servers. When you talk about cluster, it's a group of servers. And in common terms, cluster means a group of servers. Okay. So once you can connect it, you can manage it. Okay. So create clusters with just you can choose either memcached or Redis. And once you have authorized access to the cluster and it's available to state, you can log into EC2 rooms and connect it to the node in the cluster. You can connect the node to the particular cluster, okay, like the DB node or DB node and so on. Right? So you have what you can have memcached, you can have Redis, it supports both. Service updates. So if you can do memcache, okay, when you say create, it asks to create a cluster. So you can have cluster engine in memory, you can use Redis or memcache. In memory data structure used in use as database, cache, and message broker. Elastic cache for Redis offers multi AZ with auto failure. And what do memcache offers? High performance distributed memory. So when you have lots of high performance object caching part, you can use memcache. If you have any use case scenario to have caching and message broking and having read offers to multi AZ, you can use Redis. You can always use the location as Amazon Cloud, or you can use on-premise also. Create your Elastic Cache instance using AWS Outposts, the hybrid cloud solution. And this is what it will provide. You have to provide the name, the version, the port that it is, the node type. So we have lots of node instance family available for your Elastic Cache. So then how many number of nodes that you require, and you can go to advanced settings. And when you create your cluster, will be created. Similarly, let's have an overview on Redshift. So this is how. So this also requires a cluster to be created. You can see on the left hand side, you can see you have a dashboard. Okay. How many clusters, how many nodes connected to that cluster. So data warehouse, when you talk about data warehouse, there are lots of groups of servers and used for your analytic purposes. Okay. So for your data processing and other things. So this is how it works. So one cluster can have multiple nodes. Okay. So it has on-demand nodes. You can reserve the nodes as similar to your EC2 reserve instance, on-demand instance. You can have snapshots to be created of those clusters. Okay. So if you just go to the thing. So cost-wise, you can see on-demand pricing, Redshift spectrum pricing, reserve instance pricing. You can always have a look at this video, how it works. Documentations are provided over here. You can see the benefits. Okay, what are the use cases? If I say, then you can always have the queries. You can use a query editor. You can always configure this thing with subnet groups and other parts. You can have third party, you can have marketplace available, the partner supports like business intelligence and other things. Tableau, if you want to require data integration for extract, transform, and load, you can use Matillion. So some are free or some are on paid services. So you can have AWS LakeFormation can be used. You can use AWS Glue for managed ETL services. So just for a high level, let's try to create a cluster. this is a type of unique identifier. You can give a unique identifier. Similar, your database, we can plan it for production, or you can use for free trial. Configure for learning about results. This you can use always for free trial. But depend, you know, when we create an instance, it is one instance, right? When we create a cluster, depend on nodes of this cluster, multiple servers will be created. So even if you use the free trial, it has some minimal usage that it will give you. Okay. So when you say production, let's say what I can have, I can choose n number of node types. And if I say free trial, I can have only one node, right?
Here in this service as a cluster service, we can choose a number of nodes in a cluster service, or it's a node, or it's a server. How it can be used?
So you see this thing, calculated configuration summary compute. So 2 vCPU,
yes,
node into 1 is equal to 2 vCPU. So if I say 2 vCPU node into 2, will be making me 4 vCPU. If you say 2 vCPU node into 3, so 6 vCPUs. This is how it works.
So in cluster service, it is only a service we need to install, or we need some configuration for the cluster?
So in a data warehouse, right? We will not talk about one server, right? Because you are connecting lots of data, you require lots of data processing, right? So you have to have. Yeah. So if you see over here, I have choose free trial. So because on free trial, it allows only one node. But if I go to production, okay, I can always increase the nodes.
For the cluster service, we required minimum how many nodes and maximum how much we can go for the clusters.
So if you can see, maximum 32 range, right? 1 to 32. 32 nodes per cluster.
So we can go ahead with the 32 services, 32 systems.
So how you can calculate it? You can see here, storage, the 2 vCPU. If I say DC2, if I select instance DC2, it is 2 vCPU, right? If I say I want to select DCTU 8 large, that will give me 30 vCPUs. So my one node will be 30 vCPU. If I increase the node to 2, it is 2 into 32 vCPU. That is 64 vCPU I will get in the cluster for compute.
Okay.
And similarly on the storage, 2.6 into 2.
No, I want to ask that in a cluster server, as we normally use the servers or nodes in a production, can we use the cluster servers for a production also, or we need to go cluster servers for some other purpose?
Normally, I have not used. I have just checked on the data warehouse, but in my practical experience, my past experience, I was working in Oracle. I was working as an Oracle infrastructure consultant. So where that time, you know, what we used to do, we used to have multiple servers brought into a cluster. Like if you see Oracle, we use a real application cluster, REC. So you can have two or more servers used as a single server for processing my data. Similar way. So when you say cluster, it's a group of servers. And definitely in production servers, you will require, depend on case to case scenario, how much big your data is.
Okay, thank you.
But the calculation, if you see, as I told you, right, if you see, it can one for one particular cluster, it can support up to 32 nodes. So see, that is if you select a simple DC2 inside depends on the node type also. If you select DC2 large, I have 1 to 32 range, okay, maximum 32. Okay, if I select a little more extra this thing, it ranges to 128 nodes. So I can have 128 nodes. But the more nodes I have, what will increase? cost. Okay, so this is $442,000 per month on a on-demand compute price for 128 nodes. And if I select this one, so this is only used on case-to-case scenario when you have high, you have analytic, you have high processing power required, or memory, in-memory power is required, okay, to process your data for analytic purposes, like big data requirements. Then you can use data warehouse. So if I select DC2, okay, if I select only two nodes, see $360 per month. If I increase the node, what is it increasing? The cost. As I increase the node, the storage also gets increased. See here. Got it? So this is an example. You can always practice this, but be sure that you you know in and out of the how to delete and how to this thing, because it will charge you accordingly. But for an overview, you can always come to this page just to have a check how it works. You can always do that. So in my book also, I have given some high-level overview on those parts. You can always follow this. So that's for So let's come to our topic for today. We are talking about AWS Well Architect Framework. So you know, in a cloud environment, whether I am new to cloud or my company is new to cloud adoption, okay, the main thing is the design part and the thing, right? The assessment part, because it requires lots of assessment required in the physical. Whenever you want to go to a cloud, right? How will you convince your organization? Okay, that okay. How there are two things in cloud. One is that you can have direct cost benefits available. You can have flexibility, as we talk about. You can have scalability. Okay, but how can match that? Today I am paying this for this particular thing, and I will normally when we plan or architect. On the cost arena, we always work on total cost of ownership, the TCO. So it can be for 1 year, it can be for 2 years, 3 years, okay. And based on those, we can say whether we are saving cost or cloud is benefiting us, how we can match that. Okay. So any environment, whatever, be it your infrastructure, be it your application, be it your ERP solutions or anything, or architecting and design level should be clear. Okay. So for those, right, AWS provides a framework. Even Azure provides a cloud framework for that. Okay, even Google will provide it, but AWS has its own principles to work on. So AWS Well Architect Framework, we'll talk about planning and designing cloud architecture, AWS monitoring logging tools, and hybrid cloud infrastructure. So cloud infrastructure is different from traditional on-premise infrastructure. The architect principles, there are five principles to work on. Like AWS architect framework is the following. AWS framework helps you to take informed decision, like stop guessing your capacity needs. Like today, as we explained in our previous lectures and in our open discussion of data center, right? That whenever I take a server, I will always I don't know how much data I will grow, right? So I can take an midway. Today I am taking a server with n x amount of storage attached to it, but this can survive. This capacity can use those applications for this much capacity. But I have to always think about, okay, when to add the storage, when I have to all the operation team have always have to monitor your this thing. And even as the application versions also increased normally, and the features increased, your capacity needs are get increased, right? But when you use cloud, as it is in horizontal scaling part, even talk about compute, talk about storage, talk about your network, so you don't need require to you can always scale out anytime. So test systems at production scale, always test your systems, whatever we built as from your development environment, it has always always has to be tested on the production scale to check the how it performs related to your compute, storage, database, any other things. So lower risk of architecture change. It you can automate your architecture, okay, using the automation tools like serverless, Lambda, and many other tools that are available in AWS, and allow evolutionary architectures. So when you say stop guessing your capacity needs, right? AWS eliminates you to guess work in your infrastructure capacity needs. You can use as much as little capacity as you need. I can start with very little, and I can grow as I require. Okay, and so you need automatically and scale up and scale down, as we talked about scale in, scale out concepts in our auto scaling part. This is how it is. So I don't require to see when we talk about database, right? We have lots of things available in database. 3 copies of replication, okay, your n number of terabytes can storage can be available on particular databases and all. Then networking, we have scalability. Cost wise, it is pay as you go concept. So we know where to see. I will not say cloud is very cheap, okay, but if your architecture is or your design of your cloud architecture is in such a way that it can suffice your requirements, assessed requirements, and requirements where the business processes are processed, okay, and related to what like in case you require lots of instances for media streaming, I can use Spot instance to cover that this thing. I don't want need to go to an on-demand instance. If I require some instances for very small amount of time, I can always go for on-demand instances where I don't have to pay any upfront fees or upfront cost. Okay, so this is where you have to mix and match your architecture to have your save your cost also, and have your requirement to be fulfilled. Okay. So this is how it is. So test systems at production scale. In traditional environments, it is difficult to test new products due to high cost or inability of resources. Here, as soon as you create an application or this thing, it can your data, your infrastructure is available in the cloud. You just have to scale in or scale out what requirement on the application side. So AWS Cloud allows you to create duplicate environments when you require them. So AWS lowers the risk of architecture change. It automates creation of exact replicas of your production, and you can launch new test environments as and when required. So AWS allows you to automate the creation and replication of your systems at low cost and with less effort. So audit the impact, so move into production or scrap it and start again. So when you say evolutionary architectures in traditional IT environments, you are stuck with your design decisions for the lifetime of the system, right? Because whatever host you require, right, whatever hardware you purchase, there will be a specific lifetime for that hardware. Okay, so I cannot say I have purchased a server and it will last me for ages. Okay, so with AWS you can automate and test on demand to lower the risk of design changes. New innovations can be implemented straight away. So we talked about principles, the five principles: stop guessing, lower the risk of architecture change, automate, allow evolutionary architectures. AWS has some pillars, well-articulated pillars to work on. So there are five pillars to work on, but it's security, reliability, performance efficiency, cost optimization, and operation excellence. So these are the five pillars of framework of AWS well-articulated framework works on. So one is security. So Amazon defines as security, the ability to protect information systems, okay? And the option to enable traceability, automate response to security events, focus on securing your system, automate security best practices. So if you go to a bank or if you go to any financial institution and say you want to place your data or your database onto the cloud, which will be available to a public cloud, and your users can access it over the internet or through VPN connections of my on-premise setup. Okay, the first question it will be, will my data will be secure? So that part, you know, the compliance, governance, and the compliance auditing part is taken care of by when you talk about an infrastructure level, it is taken care by the cloud provider. But whatever you are placing into it, whatever as a customer I am placing my this thing, it will be my response. So when we are placing any data in the cloud, we'll have shared resources. Just hold for a second. I'm getting a call. So as we talk about, right, AWS works on the shared responsibility. So this part, I just got a call. Am I audible, right?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
AWS shared responsibility model. The AWS shared responsibility model is divided into two sections: security in the cloud and security of the cloud. So when we say security in the cloud, right? Security of the cloud. So whatever provision of infrastructure is given by the cloud provider, is the cloud response. It is the responsibility of cloud provider. So off the cloud is always the cloud provider. But whatever things that a customer places on this, like launch in EC2 instance for his web environment, okay, and he wants IIS and Apache, he requires the patching and other things. That will be always be the customer's responsibility. So whatever, if there is any security breach within the infrastructure, okay, it will be Amazon's responsibility. But if you have placed a instance and provided the root password to an anonymous user, who is to be blamed for? The customer. Okay. So always have this in mind that cloud, any cloud provider, whether it's AWS, Azure, or Google, always it will be a shared responsibility model. Okay. Then we come to reliability, the ability to system to recover from infrastructure or service failures. So dynamically acquiring computing resources to meet demand. Right. So we saw, right, if one web server fails, cover it through auto scaling. If I use S3, if I'm placing an object, if I'm using a particular class, the copy of those data can be replicated to multiple ability zones. So this is part of an reliability where we act, single point of failure is always covered off. So reliability in the cloud allows you to perform from the following: test recovery procedures, automatically recover from failure. Okay, so in case in particular environment, I have an instance having particular Windows operating system on it, and for some reason that operating system doesn't boot up. Okay, so there may be some automatic recovery options will be there, or I can have an, if that that is not booting up or that is not coming up, I can have always have an auto scaling environment ready for me, so that I can have one more instance running in. Okay, so scale horizontally to increase aggregated system availability, stop guessing capacity. So foundation change management and failure management, performance efficiency. This is ability to use computing resources efficiently to meet system requirements and to maintain that efficiency as demand changes and technology evolves. So you can see adopt advanced technology, go global in minutes, use serverless architecture. So when you have this, you know, when you are in an architecture mode or a consultant mode, okay, or even when you are in a system operation admin, okay, you have to have these key principles in mind, that how the cloud works in, and using those principles you can place or design your architecture accordingly. Okay. So performance efficiency in the cloud consists of four areas: compute, storage, database, and space time trade-off. Okay, and when we talk about one more pillar, cost, right? This is very important when you come to cloud, because why are you moving from your on-premise setup to cloud? Definitely it will be scalability, it will give you flexibility, but the main reason is also the cost. Okay, but it doesn't mean that I keep an instance, okay, and I do not require, I create an on-demand instance and I web instance, and I do not require it for a long period of time and keep it on, I'll definitely fail in that principle, right? So where to use, how to, where to stop, what automation is required, where can I scale in, scale out, those things need to be very clear. So cost optimization, Amazon defines customer as the ability to avoid or eliminate unneeded cost or suboptimal resources. So cost of optimization is in the cloud is composed of four areas: matched supply and demand, cost effective resources, expenditure awareness, and optimizing over time. So I can start with small requirement and scale out as my demand increases. Okay. Then we have operational excellence as the fifth pillar. So Amazon defines cost optimization as the ability to avoid. So operational excellence in the cloud performs the following: perform operations with the code. Okay, so I can use serverless, or I can use infrastructure as a code, like we saw CloudFormation. Okay, where I can build the complete infrastructure with the code. So align operations processes to business objectives. Make regular small incremental changes. Test for responses to unexpected events. Learn from operational events and failures. Keep operational procedure current. So preparation, operation, responses, we can find it out. So let's come to the documentation part. So this is, you know, even if you are sitting for an exam for a solution architect, or a sysop admin for AWS, right? Or a developer associate admin, okay? You have to go through the white papers of, and you have to have clear this thing, because when the question is asked about in the certification exams, right? It will be based on these pillars and the design principles. So where will, it will, for example, it will say, okay, I want to, in a particular use case scenario, it will be explained, and it will ask you, okay, where can I have a scale out also and optimize my cost. Okay, those type of questions can be. So if you know little, you have a concept clear on those this design principles and pillars. So those for those things. You have well AWS well architect documentation is all over. You don't have to, there is no charges for this. Okay. And let's learn your major and build using your architecture best practices. So AWS well helps you to helps cloud architects build secure, high performing, resilient, and efficient infrastructure of their applications. So we can see over here. So what are the five pillars? It is already, what is the framework overview? It is explained over here. Okay, key concept, design principles, and architectural best practices. Okay, what are the pillars? It is already mentioned over here. Okay. You can have, if you require, if you are using your Internet of Things or using your machine learning, analytics, or serverless, there is always one more tool called AWS Well Architected Lenses. So all the white. So there are some, you know. And when you go to up, you have an specific tool available for this, where we can specify your workloads, what are the workloads, and it your AWS will guide you based on the best practices. Okay, you can have, you can go to this link for AWS Well Architect guidance. Okay, you have an AWS Architect Center. So you can have all your documentations and like what tool you can, what is AWS Architect Labs or reference architectures that you can, what are the reference architectures that you can check for if you want compute and HSP, if you want related with database. So just say compute and HSP, HPC. So you can have lots of, you know, you can have like reference, like scale out computing in AWS, decoupled service scheduler. If I select scale out, what will give me? Taking a lot of time. Okay, so see this, it will give you a reference diagram where. So while working on the book also, right? Once you are familiar with everything, all the most of the this thing, you can always come over here and use this diagram to build your architecture as a reference architecture. So AWS documentation provides you lots of things. That's the reason I am always pointing you out to the AWS documentation. Okay, if you require. If you have a habit of reading and exploring, this is a good, very good place to come in. Just closing it. Okay. So let's talk about this. If we already saw this, okay, there is no particular. So I can. This. Okay. So whenever you know we talk about well architected frameworks, they are predefined white papers published by this thing. Whatever I explained to you, right, is already published by AWS on its documentation page. So this is where you can come in, and this is updated white paper updated on 9 July 2020. Okay, and when you come down, so you will always see what are the pillars of your thing. Okay, on a short form, you can always check it out why and which, like an operational excellence, the ability to run and monitor systems. Okay, the security, the ability to protect information systems and assets. This is how it provides you. And when you come over here, you will always see the white papers. So in your examination also, you have to go through this, right? Just a last minute review of these white papers. Okay. So these are updated white papers. So just if you go to a PDF format, I've already downloaded it. I'll show you in a while. And you can always use the well-architect tool to reflect the updates and that we made. So I'll show you how it looks like. So and it covers all the pillars of your well-architect framework. So I just downloaded all those framework. So just come down. I will show you some of them. Okay. Rest I will give you. I will forward you the link and you can download those things. So yeah. Let's see. Let's check out for the cost one. So if you see here, well-architected framework, all the table of contents are being provided, what it provides, it explains everything in detail. Okay. Why should we use it? And appendix questions for best practices. It is already like the things are there, right? So when you come to five pillars of this thing, you can always come over here, see the design principles. Every pillar will have its own design principles, definition, best practices, and resources that it will have. So what are the design principles? Operational excellence, perform operations as a code, whatever we explained in our slides mentioned over here. What is definition? There are four best practices. You can use organization, you can prepare, you can operate, you can evolve. Okay, so this is how it shows. There's a theory part is there in this, but just one time review, you go through this one time, okay, because it will help you to increase your concepts or clear your concepts depending on the cloud design and cloud architecture. So whenever there is any consultant coming for cloud provision, they always talk about, they will always guide you over these principles. Okay. And then your requirement. Okay. So your conclusions. So just show you all those things. So this you can give it downloaded. I will share you the link on the WhatsApp. You can always download it. Just see this. I'm opening the white paper for cost pillar. So we have a specific, these things are there. Cost optimization, practice, financial management, functional ownerships, and see how you can do cost optimization. What is the design principles of cost optimizations are mentioned over here. Functional ownership, establish your cost optimization function, financial and technology partnership, establish your partnership between the finance and technology. Yeah. So there are some things, how you can establish your cloud budget and forecast, how you can do that. You can come over here and you can use AWS Cloud Explorer, or you can use a monthly price calculator also. That I will show you tomorrow, inshallah. This is how it comes up. So you can always go through these pages. I've already explained this. I'll just close this. So let's check about the tool. Computer Management Console. I'll say Well Architect. I'm gonna say Well also, you'll give me the tool. Well Architect tool. Okay. So how it works. Identify the workload to review. Okay. And then we'll define a workload. We'll submit that workload to AWS Well Architect tool. And based on these principles, it will suggest me or guide me accordingly with the best practices. So get what can I do with this? Get architectural guidance, enable consistent governance, consistently improve architectures. So it is, you see, it's free of cost. So just let's see what is defined the network. So what, when you say define the workload, so workload properties, you can have a name to that workload. Like the name must be at least whatever name you have to, a brief description of the workload to document its scope. Okay. Who will be the reviewer of this, you know, the email addresses and those production, whether you want a pre-production environment or you want a production environment. You can use this tool as an assessment tool, right? So how many regions do you require? Those you can choose it. Okay. Non-AWS regions, if it's there, they are there. Well, how many account IDs will be provided over here? A link to your architecture. If you have any specific on-premise architecture design, or you have already worked on some cloud design, you can always submit that. What is the industry type that you can, that is your customer is, education or agriculture or IT or so on, then go, always go go for that. I'm not giving, maybe I may not be. So all these things, you know, there is a documentation for this. So well, I say AWS, document. Architect two. So there is a user guide for this. You can always refer to the user guide. Okay. So what it will assist you, assisting with document and decisions to that you make. Well, we have already spoken about definition of work. So what are the W tool? It will, a workload identifies a set of components that deliver business value. The workload is usually the level of detail that business and technology leaders communicate about. Examples of workloads, including marketing websites, e-commerce websites, the backend for a mobile app, analytical platforms, and so on. So you have milestones, marquee changes in your architecture as it evolves. You have high risk issues, HRIs. You'll have medium risk issues, MRIs. Yeah. And can use this foundation technical review. When you say get started, provision, I am missing. You can always, you can define a workload, then you can document a workload and saving a milestone for it. So you can always go through this. You have a tutorial for that. Define workload, document workload, say it. This same thing is reflected in my book. I didn't do it specifically, okay, but you can try. I just have I have explained the steps in my book just for an overview. Okay. You can always, what are workloads, viewing a workload, how you can do that, sharing a, you can always share a workload with, if you require, that is also there. So you can always use this user guide working with AWS Well Architect tool. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
So coming to my book, 414 page. I have already mentioned this in my book. Just a high overview, whatever I explained. So you come to know about these things. Definition excellence, prepare, operate, so how evolve, so on. So considering the white papers, I have just mentioned the key things over here, but it's better you go through the, you can also refer this, or it's better to check the white papers. You come down. You can, well, I have explained the well-architected tool also. So it's a get free architecture guidelines. What is it used for? What are the concepts of those WA tools? What are steps that you need to do? Everything is explained over here. Now we talked about, you know, I'll just extend this for 10, 15 minutes more. I'll talk about a very important topic. I'll refer only the book for this, just to for your so we talked about, you know, we talked about compute, we talked about storage, we talked about database, we talked about well architected design techniques, we talked about cloud monitoring and auditing. Okay, we talked about IAM roles and other things. Now the thing is that I am a customer, I have a data, so how can I migrate those data? What is the online transfer option tools or options available in AWS? What are the offline transfer tools that are available in AWS? So in my book, there is a section for that thing. Education, organization, cloud. So you can see here, cloud migration service 332. Let's click this one. Okay. So you have migration and transfer on AWS, right? So the most complete. So there is a. Then I'll show you in the portal also these things. So we have lots of transfer services available. Migration evaluator creates a business case for AWS to gain visibility. Migration hub, AWS application disaster discovery resources. So migration services, you can automate, schedule, and track incremental replications for levers of volumes. Database migration, you can use VMware cloud on AWS. There is a tool in migration services where you can use preferred service for all vSphere. If I am a customer having all my current services in VMware virtualization, using VMware virtualization, and I need to migrate it to the cloud, I can use this tool, VMware cloud on AWS. Okay, so AWS data sync, easily data transfer from AWS to 10x for online transfer. We can have AWS transfer family. Okay, using Amazon S3, using SFTP for an online or offline transfer. We can have an Snow family for offline transfer of my data to my AWS cloud. So I'll just explain you how it is. So you have cloud and your migration. There's a tool combined with your AWS where you can automate your mass migration to the AWS cloud. So we'll first speak about SOAP family, that is the offline transfer of my data from my on-premise to my AWS cloud. So what are those members? So we say Snow family. So there are, you know, you have Snow Cone, you have Snowmobile, you have Snowball, you have Snowmobile. There are types of families available in for offline transfer of my data. So when you say the lowest part of the smallest part of the snow family is the snow cone. So where can you use it? Snowcone is the smallest member of the AWS Snow family of edge computing data transfer services. And where I can use this Snow family for offline transfer. If I don't want to use over the internet and there is a very large amount of data that needs to be transferred, I can use Snow family. So AWS Snow family of edge computing and data transfer devices, Snowcone is a portable, rugged and secure. You can use Snowcone to collect, process and move data to AWS services and either offline by shipping the device or online with AWS data sync. So you can have, you know, usage scenario, edge computing, data transfer and edge storage. It can be it has a hard disk up to 8 TB. It has a because it provides edge computing also, so it has a it is a box like this. So this can be ordered, you have through the console. You can fill a form and you can order this thing based on your requirement. So and AWS, Amazon ships it to your on-premise. This thing you can connect this to your infrastructure. You can load your data that is required, like in terms of file services, right? If you have a lots of objects, lots of data that's required to be stored in your S3 storage of AWS, you can always connect this to your infrastructure. You can offload your data on your on-premise to or copy your data of on-premise over here, and then this ship back to the AWS. This thing connected, it will be connected to on the AWS at the AWS premises, and your data can be transferred. So you don't require any online internet charges for that. Okay. So this is how it is. Then you can have Snowball. AWS Snowball is the data migration and edge computing device that comes in two device options, compute optimized and storage optimized. So it comes in two options, user scenario, data transfer and edge storage, where you, in Snowball edge compute optimized, if you have data transfer and you require edge computing. So this is all the capacity requirements mentioned over here, like 440 vCPUs, 52 vCPUs, memory is also there. And if you have lots of like petabytes of data, okay, to be transferred to the AWS thing, so then we have a large truck sized, it will be a container completing having a large number of storage options, and it is known as Snowmobile. So what it is, Snowmobile moves up to 100 petabytes of data into a 45 foot long rug size shipping container, and is ideal for multi petabyte or exabyte scale digital media migrations. Okay, so Snowmobile is a tamper resistant, waterproof, temperature controlled, with multiple layers of logical and physical security, including encryption, fire suppression, and so on. The user scenario is data transfer up to 100 petabytes of data. It has a network interface for 6 x 40 GB. And the pricing of the Snow family devices and vehicles are owned and managed by AWS. So customers do not need to invest in new hardware. Customers pay varying startup fees plus shipping per device. So there may be some startup fees and shipping charges will be there. So multiple devices can be requested in parallel if more capacity is needed. AWS monitors its health. So I'll just show you this, how it looks like. And you know, earlier when we used to connect this Snowcone or Snow family, we had to use CLI command. So now AWS has created GUI tool for that, AWS Ops Hub, where you can use those. You can connect to Ops Hub and configure your or copy your data accordingly. So there are lots of things available. Okay, just to show you this on the console. come over here. I say sumo AWS slow family. That will give you all this. You can have always an overview on this. Come over here. We have a video. What is it? Okay. What is Snowcall? You can have an look and feel with this link also. Okay. You can come over here. What is link? You have Snowball Edge overview. Okay. So when you come over here, you can order and Snow AWS Snow Family. So you have to Snow Family. Jobs import into Amazon S3, export from Amazon S3, local compute and storage only. So perform local compute storage workloads without transferring data when you order multiple devices. Let's say import out this thing and say next. It will ask you for the shipping details. Then it will ask you for what are the job details. It will choose your security preferences. Okay, so it can ship speed 1 day or 2 day. Is there? It depends on those things, and download the AWS Ops Hub and review and create a job. Once this job is created, okay, the AWS will provide you. You know, it will ship that device to your on-premise location. So just for the services part. I have migration and cloud migration. When you come to the migration and transfer, you'll find all these migration components over here. So Snow Family is part of your migration and transfer. The server migration service, database migration service, application discovery service. So in my book, I explained on the Snow Family part. In my book, we have AWS Transfer Family also. So AWS Family is fully managed AWS service that you use transfer files into in and out of Amazon S3 storage over the following protocols. So if I am on to use my internet link or any specific direct connect link where I can transfer my data through using SSH and FTP protocols, secure FTP protocols, I can do that, okay, using AWS Transfer Family. So AWS Transfer Family for SFTP, file transfer protocol, it supports file transfer protocol also. You can have file transfer protocol, you have secure file transfer protocol is also there. And this is how you can do it. You know, create an Amazon bucket optionally, and there's a link to do that, right? So apart from that, we have DataSync. DataSync makes it simple and fast to move large amounts of data online between on-premise storage and Amazon S3, Elastic File System, or Amazon FSx file Windows file server. So manual tasks related to DataSync can slow down migration and burden IT operations. So instead of transferring it manually, you can use Amazon AWS DataSync that allows to automatically handles many of these tasks, including scripting, scheduling, monitoring and transfers. So these all are, you know, migration tools that you can use. We have AWS Cloud Endure. And Cloud Endure is a migration tool that provides flexible migration and disaster recovery solutions. So this is what it can do. So everything is on a high level part, right? Everything is mentioned over here. So you have to just go through it. You should know some part of your migration topics also. So that is why. And you have, we talked about AWS storage gateway, that we have file gateway, volume gateway, tape gateway. That is also a part of your migration tools available with AWS. Any questions over here?
No, sir, it's clear up to this point.
So there are lots of things. As I told you, right, I am just touching the basics of your AWS, but this is an ocean. AWS cloud is an ocean.
Yes, sir. In each and every service, there are a whole lot of things that we can do. So we have to sit back and we have to go through the documentation and the book and
practice. No, if you start with this book, okay?
Yes, sir. Practices, we will start with
In a very high level, this thing, I have already explained everything.
Yes, sir.
So you don't have to go back and forth with the document. Yes, you are always, you can always go to a documentation to explore
sir.
More things.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
which I may not have, or I may have missed out.
Okay. Yes.
But to start off, you can always use this book as a handy tool.
Handy, yes, sir. It's like a lab manual. Okay. Yes.
So just coming, we didn't do lots of, quiz in our last sessions. Let's check if we can have in complete this in next 10 minutes, and we'll close for the day. So security groups are stateful in nature. True or false?
You said true.
So security groups are applied on instances. True or false?
It's true, sir. True.
So network ACL are applied on subnets.
Yes, sir. True, sir.
So how many VPCs are supported per region?
5.
The answer? Yeah, answer is 5. Answer is 5. So Dash is a cloud DNS system.
Route 53.
Route 53 is the cloud DNS system provider. Okay. So continue to the next section. Not this one. Okay. My screen is visible to everybody, right?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
So, Amazon Simple Storage S3 is Dash Storage Service.
Files, block storage, sir.
Is it a block storage?
No, sir. It's an object storage service.
Yeah, it's an object storage.
Object storage, yes, sir.
Yeah. In S3, objects are stored in minimum of Dash availability zones.
Three availability zones.
Very good. Dash also allows to host your static website at low cost.
Route 53.
Static website. Where can I host?
Static website. S3, sir.
Amazon S3. I can host
S3,
AWS S3 objects are uploaded in?
Buckets.
Buckets. Very good. In AWS S3, Dash data consistency model allows you to retrieve data immediately after creation. Which consistency model?
Read
after write consistency.
Read after write consistency.
The following are the AWS storage classes, multiple choice.
All the above, sir.
Yeah. Standard IA.
Yes, sir. Standard IA, Glacier.
Dash storage class is used for long-term data archiving.
Glacier.
Yes, very good. In S3 lifecycle management transition actions, moves data to Dash storage after a month. Standard IA to Glacier.
Yes, sir.
Dash helps client web applications located in one domain to interact with resources in another domain.
This option, cross-origin
resource sharing. Okay. Dash cloud data migration service is used for offline transfer, data transfer to AWS cloud or S3.
Amazon Snow Family.
Yeah, Amazon Snow Family. Very good.
What we have seen today.
Yeah. So this is what now, actually I have covered most of the topic. So tomorrow we'll talk about costing, okay?
Yes, sir.
And then it is up to you whether you want to continue on Friday or you have to ask me questions or just think that is up to you. So tomorrow it will be a very light topic that I will be covering. And I hope that you are doing the assignments, because I'm providing you assignments. Almost 9 assignments have been submitted, and I hope you are doing it.
Yes, sir.
Any questions? Anything that needs to be addressed?
3-4 assignments I have done, sir. Like repairing, I have to do still. But definitely I'll complete it, or I'll do, sir.
Okay.
First 3 assignments I could complete, alhamdulillah. But from 4 onwards, I have to do, sir.
The thing is that I have, in a simple way, I have explained you everything and the concept.
Yes, sir.
I have prepared the resources. I have provided you what task you need to do. Okay.
Yes, sir.
In somewhere where you can't, you have to. Where in my book you will have to go to Art 53. I have just tweeted that assignment in some cases, if you have seen it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
It's up to you now. I have done my part.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. Exactly.
Whether you have to do, not to, it's up to you. Okay.
Inshallah, will do, sir.
Okay. So let's close for the day. We'll see you tomorrow, inshallah.
Thank you, sir. Jazakallah khair.